Good afternoon, participants. This is an interesting session on the neuroscientific perspectives of learning. And we have a very eminent speaker with us, Dr. Arun Pratap Sikarwar. He is an assistant professor at the Department of Zoology, Faculty of Science, and he has a long standing in teaching neuroscience for a very long time, and he has also taken up this effort to bring neuroscience for the benefit of the BSc Cognitive Science courses which have recently been started. The effort of the Faculty of Education in starting School of Education and Brain-Based Learning has further excited him to join hands with the Faculty of Education to bring the brain-based learning even more deeper, bringing neuroscientific perspective to it. His talk would of course be intense in terms of neuroscientific aspects, but he has promised that he will make sure that this neuroscience will be appreciated by everybody who's sitting here. And please do understand, if you want to drive a car, you must know how the car is built. Similarly, if you want to understand psychology, it is important that the psychology runs in the mind, and which is also embedded inside the brain, and therefore how the brain is organized or how the brain operates is equally as important as you would have to understand a computer to run computer science. It's more or less the same thing. Without saying too much, I would just want to introduce Dr. Sikarwar. Dr. Sikarwar is BSc in Botany Zoology from B.R. Ambedkar University in 2000. He is an MSc in Biotechnology in first division from BHU Banaras in 2002. And he's done his PhD in Biochemistry in 2009 from National Institute of Research in Reproductive Health, University of Mumbai, India. He's also done his MBA from Symbiosis Center for Distance Learning, and he has some e-learning online course contents related to neuroscience for personal development and winning strategies of teaching, which he has also done. His professional experience has been that he has been a research associate at Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research, JNCSR, Bangalore, in Chromatin Biology Laboratory. He is a postdoctoral associate at Institute of Biomedicine, Aarhus, Denmark, postdoctoral associate in Weill Cornell Medicine in Qatar, one of the institutions associated with Cornell University. And he has been assistant professor in the Department of Zoology since 2014. His enormous international experience and his enormous study in the fields of neuroscience brings very rich content to our students in BSc Cognitive Science, and I am sure he will be able to impress details to you when he goes through the lecture. He is qualified GATE, NET, UGC CSIR, and has got early career fellowship from Wellcome Trust, DBT, India Alliance. All of these are supposed to be very high level, national level of national level repute, and has published extensively in various journals and conferences. Interestingly, he has several radio talks which can easily be accessed on YouTube by putting his name. You should be able to access. For example, one of the talks is Human Brain versus Computer, which he presented in January 2019 this year. Therapeutic Yoga Myth or Fact, which he presented in June 2018. Human Brain Memories and Neurobiology, which he presented in March 2018. So not only you will hear the lecture here, but we'll also be able to access some of the YouTube lectures that he has put in. Then he spoke on a radio talk on Vulnerology, Science of Dreams in 2017. Other than that, he also participates in many other radio talks related to Chandrayaan, Vikram Lander. Yeah, of course. These are TV talks, of course. These are on Aaj Tak, India TV as well. And he has been facilitated as an Innovative Teacher Award and Science Communication Award. And there's a lot list of research papers that he has published. And he is actively into research, as many as 5 students pursuing PhD, and almost as many doing MSc dissertations with him. And therefore, he clearly is an approachable person. And if anybody has any curiosity related to neuroscience, they should be able to reach out to him in Department of Zoology. With this short introduction, I will invite Dr. Sikarwar to enthrall the audience. Dr. Sikarwar, please.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm so happy to be here. It's my second term on this dais. Last year, I was giving my TED talk here while recording on this dais, and this is my second opportunity to be here in this hall. And I'm thankful that sir explained about me in several forms that I have come across so far in my academics and my professional career. Basically, I'm a neurobiologist. Before that, I was in reproductive biology and chromatin biology at various national and international institutes. But now, I'm totally in the neurobiology. This morning, I was told that not everyone is biologic background, especially neurobiology also. And it's a varied audience here. So I've kept my PPT with a lot of videos and lot of basic information that not only biology background students should know, but everyone, like psychology or arts or anyone. So I'll jump to my PPT now. This topic on brain anatomy and its functioning, and how the brain is important for everyone, So it is not that solely property for a neurobiologist, it's for everyone. Before this brain is part of human body, so I'll go back in the evolutionarily part, how the brain has come up in a human body, and before that also how humans have come up. So as you all know that around Earth is 4.6 billion years old, 4.6 billion, and there's a lot of, evidences are coming day by day in the geological and biological evolution from that background. And human evolution is the evolutionary process led to the emergence of anatomically modern humans, beginning with the evolutionary history of primates. And during the course of evolution, in last just few million years, not even billions, these few important points have come up: bipedalism and memory formation, and cognitive part as well, language and civilization. This all were very important for today's, the emergence of human as one of the successful animal on the earth. If we see this chronological part of 4.6 billion, then we are only this much, out of 4.6, it's just few million, just point-wise. So the humans have come up in the present avatar in just few million years back. Otherwise, everything was unicellular, and then multicellularity came up, and then a lot of organisms came up. So whatever has happened has happened because of brain, because brain is so special and brain is so smart for humans only, that we are so cognitive and successful animal on the earth. This is the human skull of present a human, and this is the very past, very much old. And obviously you might have heard in the 10th during human evolution that cranium capacity had changed. So initially it was like 700 cc. Right now it is like 1700 cc in that 1.4 kg brain lies. So the brain capacity or cranium capacity has increased, so it housed a bigger brain. And in a 70 kg human being, about 1.4 kg brain lies in our brain, in our cranium. So this weight is like 2% of our body mass. However, this is the maximum. Even in comparison of elephant and dolphin, this brain by body mass is the highest. Now, if you see that previously less than 1 billion years, there used to be Ramapithecus, Australopithecus, then Cro-Magnon, and this is modern Homo sapiens. So modern Homo sapiens has come up in last few lakh of years in that period only. And this has become very important for human survival, social interaction, language, as I told you. And this has happened only in last 300 or 200 years period. Before that it was, you know, prehistoric human was only having food and then just doing mediocre jobs and nothing else. Now, I want to give emphasis over the discovery of fire with the human evolution, how fire evolution has, you know, strategically very much enhanced this brain evolution. So it is presumed that up to 4 lakh to 2.3 lakh years ago, or even less than 1.4, we don't know the exact time, it's just a rough estimate, use of fire had started by Homo erectus. The control of fire by early humans was a turning point in the cultural aspect of human evolution. Because before fire, humans were only limited for the daytime functioning, or not in the night time. And also before fire was not discovered, the food habit was eating raw food, raw meat or vegetables. So that time the human body was not able to collect more kilocalorie. Okay, and after this, human geographical dispersal, cultural innovations, changes to diet and behavior has abruptly changed after the fire. However, I want to tell that paye ka aviskar, wo bhi main aata hai, wo mechanical evolution ke liye, other than fire. There was a TED talk around 5-6 years back of Susana Herculon Hodges. She's a Brazilian scientist right now in Utah. She's a comparative neuroanatomist. So she was studying how the brain of different animals is different and what are the similarities and dissimilarities between the brains of like comparative part. So then she had one technique, and then she discovered that human brain of like an adult human being is around 86 billion, not 100 billion neurons that lies still in all the books. However, it is slightly less from 100 billion to 86, so interchangeably you can come across in several neurobiology books, it is 86 or 100. Okay, so as you all know that human brain is 1.4 kg mass, it's very, very soft tissue, I will show you in the next slide. And the structural and functional unit of brain is neuron. And neuron is just like a tree, in that axon is like a stem, and then there are dendrites, axonal terminals, and it is very electrically excitable cell in the body. Human body is made up of around 200 different kinds of cells, so it is one of them. And human body is made up of about 37.2 billion cells. So out of 37.2 trillion cells, about 100 billion are the neurons. However, other cells are the blood cells, etc. Now, in comparison to human being, which is like 70-80 kg, 1.4 kg is like 2%. And see the elephant, which is like 5,000 kg, but the brain weight is almost 4 to 5 kg. So it is not even 2%, rather it is even less than 0.2%. So the body mass, the brain and body mass ratio is quite less. So the human brain is the spatial and better, because in comparison to the body mass, it is the higher, so that it can house more number of neurons. And then why the human brain is so expensive? Now, okay, this process, expenditure of the neuron comes from the discovery of fire. Before fire was not discovered, human food was raw foods and kaccha khana tha, like that. So right now we need around 2000 kilocalorie per day. For one day expenditure it is 2000 kilocalorie. And if you come across the expenditure of the neurons, then 1 billion of neurons equalizes like 6 kilocalorie per day, because they had a lot of electrical transmission in the nerve conduction. So this way 86 billion, or if I consider 100 billion, it is like 600 kilocalorie. So after 2000 kilocalorie of our intake, only the brain of 2% is consuming like 25% of the calorie intake. So in the last few million years back, when the fire was ready, humans were able to have food habit of one sit, like two or three sitting in a daytime, of semi-digestible food. And this semi-digestible food habit is only and only for the human in the world so far. So that way he could utilize the daytime for other cognitive function. For that period, human was able to go out, he could go to see the rivers, and then civilization started. And also human were able to do night jobs, like they could fire some mashal kind of thing, and wo raat ko bhi kaam karne laga. So discovery of fire led to the cooking habit of eating food, that led to the more intake of the energy, and then brain capacity increased to house bigger brain. Okay, and so as I told you, 25% kilocalorie goes only with the brain. However, there are other organ systems, like 12 organ systems in the body, they take the remaining 75% kilocalorie. Now this is that comparative neuroanatomy, how this is the human brain, okay, and this is in comparison to others. So cranium is very hard bone, that houses the brain. So pericardium, then skin, then meninges is there, dura mater, arachnoid, pia, and then brain. So to increase the surface area of the cortical neurons, human brain develop these gyri and sulci. So gyri are the, you know, bulges, and sulci are the deep grooves. This way the cortical neurons was increased like 4 to 5 times. Otherwise, if it was a smooth brain, then cortical neurons would have been very less. Jabki cortical neurons are very much necessary for the neural brain circuit. Because as I told you, dolphin and elephant body is quite big. Even brain is like 10 kg in dolphin, but dolphin size is several thousand kg, so it is not like 2%. Now coming to that organ system of the human body, so there are 12 organ systems. You can see immune system, endocrine, muscular, whatever, but the big boss is nervous system. Human body is complicated system made up of, as I told you, 37.2 trillion cells. Then cells make tissue, tissues make organ, and organ make organ systems. Those are like 12 in a human body. In order for life to function properly, however, these systems work together. Now you might have seen, you know, nowadays heart transplant is possible, kidney transplant is possible, even a skin transplant is possible. But so far, brain transplant, forget brain, even hair transplant is not possible. And in next 5 to 10 years, I've come across some reports, some Russian medical doctor, he plans to do the first hair transplant in a cadaver, from a cadaver body. And for that mouse hair transplantation, and even rat, it's being successful by 3 months. So, but the big problem is, after the hair transplant, sometimes the body does not recognize the other body's head in the other body, because probably something happens that the neurons or peripheral nervous system of the other part of the body don't take the command of CNS system of another head. So this is happening in the animals, so it's a big question so far, how in future it could be possible. Number two, the consumption of all the this peripheral nervous system through the spinal cord, it's very tough job. So it could be like several days job. And after the particular surgery, person will be in coma for at least 4 or 6 months in human, it is presumed. Like, so we don't know the coma will be, revert back or not. So this is the front of the brain, like this. This is your forehead here. This is pons medulla and hind brain. These are gyri and sulci. And these are two hemispheres, left and right hemisphere. This is just 180 degree flip of this. So this is the back. This is cerebellum. I'll come across, cerebellum is related to the body posture and movement. while cerebrum is the largest part, it's like up to 3/4 of the total brain. This is the actual Susan Stinsas from University of Utah, Salt Lake City. She has some videos, and when I was in US, I met her also. So this is like 15 May before died, Alzheimer's patient, freshly dissected brain. So this is cerebellum, this is cerebrum. And if you put a finger here, then through the corpus callosum, it can easily detach out left and right hemisphere. And these are cerebral arteries, they give blood supply, and then CSF is percolated inside the brain. This is the, if you do palpitation, if you are good enough and fortunate to see the brain, it is so much soft, like a paneer or tofu. It's very soft, and it is so much soft that if you put a brain on a table, then it can fall down on its own weight. So it is not even having very hard cytoarchitecture in it. Now, so this cerebrum is having four parts: frontal, that forehead, temporal lobe over the ears, parietal is somewhere on the up, and occipital just up or dorsal part of the cerebellum. And then central sulcus is the main groove, main sulcus that divides frontal with the parietal, and this is the sylvian fissure or lateral fissure that divides frontal parietal both from the temporal lobe. So this way, this is the cytoarchitecture. There was a German scientist, Connie Bayern Brodmann, in 1890s. Brodmann, he was a neurosurgeon that time. That time not big medical biology was available, but so far he was able to do it. Brodmann divided these all brain parts, human brain parts, in 52 areas. This was necessary for neurosurgeons, especially when they were doing some surgery. Even till today, when a doctor does surgery, that time in the report, the doctor writes that I have done a surgery or some resurrection or some part in a Brodmann area 7 or Brodmann area 37, like that. So their total brain is divided into the 52 Brodmann areas. This is cytoarchitecture, and this way brain is divided into the various like mohallas and colonies kind of thing you can imagine the paralogy. Now, I will brief the parts of the frontal lobe. So what frontal lobe does? Frontal lobe is very important. It is neocortex also called so. And it is recently, like few million years back, it is developed. And frontal lobe is... Okay. Frontal lobe is very much necessary for the decision making. It is the main, like whatever you want to do. Judgment, it is related to behavior, reasoning, mathematical calculation, this all. Temporal lobe similarly is related to the speech, that is Barnick's area is there. So speech comprehension, like how you understand a language and how you react with some particular language, that is in the temporal lobe. Similarly, cerebellum is for the balance, coordination and the muscle control. Occipital lobe is the smallest among all the cerebrum parts. It is related to the vision. So there's an optic chiasma from the eye. There's an optic nerve that makes optic chiasma or contralateral part. It goes to the occipital lobe, where based on a previous memory of some image or some person, our eyes tell and infer that this is that individual or whosoever. Parietal is related to the somatosensory or our senses, touch receptor. It could be thermoreceptor, it could be temperature, it could be a tingling sensation. All senses, okay, they are related to the parietal lobe. This is similar picture. Here, two things I want to reiterate here. Broca's center lying in a Brodmann, in this frontal lobe. It is speech production. Speech production takes place with the help of around 10 muscles of the face, masseter muscles, and cheek muscles, lip, and even tongue. That is controlled by the Broca center. It was named on a Paul Broca, who discovered this part. Similarly, Barnick's area is related to the language comprehension. As I told you, in a multiglot people, that some people understand more than two or three languages, how they converse at the same time in various languages. Okay. Now, for the brain, there's a triune brain. It is very easy method of letting understand this brain, triune brain. It was given by Paul D. MacLean, American neuroscientist. It is based on a very basic fundamental to make it understandable for a common man. So he divides the brain during the evolution, neurodevelopment and biology. The very first appeared was the lizard brain, or brainstem and cerebellum, this one, red color, and it is related to the autopilot or fight or flight method. So it was just very much necessary, and especially autonomic function also, like heart, respiration, etc. So you remember like 3-4 million, 200 or 300 million years back, when Australopithecus, Ramapithecus, they were not having very much cognitive part. They were just eating khana and then living, you know, doing reproduction, and that's all. So this formed very much early. Then later on, when the fire was discovered and, you know, slightly social network increased, that time, other than lizard brain, limbic system has appeared, second part, limbic system. It is related to the emotions, memories, because memories, I will tell you, because hippocampus lies in the limbic system, that is related to the memory formation, and habits and attachment, that social bonding kind of thing. This is that period when the mammalian brain appeared. That time we were probably having Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, and that, you know, Persian civilization kind of thing that could have happened. And this is very much recent neocortex, like maybe 1 million year back, where this upper part and cortical neuron and lot of Jarvi and sulci, and this has happened, you know, in neocortex brain. This is related to the language, abstract thought, imagination. Imagination is necessary for the scientific temperament, as you know. And then consciousness also, reasoning and rationalizing. Okay, so neocortex is part of the cerebral cortex, which is critical part of the limbic system. It is involved in the higher cognitive functions, such as sensory perception, generation of motor commands, spatial reasoning, conscious thought, and languages, etc. So this is more important for us. Unlike, you know, other animals and are even neighbors, like old world monkey, chimpanzee, or macaque monkey, they might have lizard brain, mammalian brain to some extent. But remember, neocortex is not that developed in those hominid animals. So limbic system, because the name system itself, so it is having more than one organ together. It's a complex set of brain structure. It's also called as a paleomammalian brain, and it is located on both sides of the thalamus. And this is having collection of structures. As I told you, the names are fornix, columns of fornix, mammillary body, etc., etc. There are a lot of, you know, around 10 different organs make this total limbic system. Okay, and here the most important limbic system is the hippocampus, development of hippocampus, that led to the complex neural structure like a seahorse. Okay, so it lies in a 180 amygdala. There are two amygdala in a brain, in both hemispheres, so that's why it's called amygdala. Amygdala is not there, so person don't feel fear. The fear things goes. So such person may go up on a roof and can jump. They can go to do any, you know, extraordinary job. And this happens in a few cases of human. Now, coming back, so as I told you, there are a lot of brain part, cerebrum having four part, then I told you, basal ganglia, then limbic system, then hindbrain. They all are related to each other with the network of nerve fibers from one part of the brain to the another part. And there are a lot of foramen magnum, so many foramen, in through that network of neurons pass on in the brain. It is the similar analogy in case of a computer chip, or where the network goes on, you know, from one point to another. So now, as you know, that among all the organ systems, like orthology, or you know, haddi rog visheshak wala jo hota hai, that is totally 100% successful. Like khud bhi bone tote now, everyone, any bone can be put. But remember, nervous system, especially CNS or peripheral nervous system, it is not that easy. You remember Stephen Hawking case? He was having amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. Was he able to become correct? No, thought like he was not able to. Because nervous system, first though, we don't know the typical, you know, the basic of neurobiology. So forget about how we can treat such patients into today.
So a few months back, I was called upon Kela Sathyarthi, the Nobel Prize and Peace Prize winner. And then I was for several hours with meeting. So I was asked that, he was asking me, what is sympathy, empathy and compassionate hurt? Because he's a Nobel laureate, so he's working towards this compassionate quotient, CQ. So that time I was having my explanation of this limbic system, you remember, motivation, how a person becomes so bad that he becomes criminal, someone does a crime, some people even don't accept their fault, and few people are very mild and generous. So how this happens, you know, it's not that easy job, but it was his work, so I was helping in this work, and I'm having touch with him. Now coming back to the brain, so brain is like a hardware, as I told you. Over that mind we develop like a software. So with the time, brain is more or less same among we all of us, remember. But with the help of education, step by step, our exposure to national and international or meeting some great people, we develop newer and newer memory. And newer and newer memory formation takes help of, you know, making any explanation with the interchangeable. Like a person with more cognitive part can have more than one option to explain one phenomena. So there are a lot of faculties of the mind, like perception, reason, memory, will, imagination and intuition. Intuition you might have heard, people used to say 2-3 days back, mujhe achha nahi lag raha hai, something bura hone wala hai. So even this science is parascience part, and no one knows how intuition comes. Even a cat and few animals shows this very much correctly before earthquake comes. So in nature there are a lot of intuition. I want to come on this memory, because memory is the bundle of knowledge that remain our mind every time. Like I'm having some memory, that's why I'm able to make my presentation here. Similarly, if I'm talking to you, that time you will be taking help of your old memory, that is not old, like previous batch of memory. Over that you behave your cognitive part. So now coming to that memory, what is memory in the brain? So memory is one of the faculties, as I told you, one of the faculties of a mind. And mind develops in a healthy brain. So a healthy brain always will have a healthy mind. But healthy mind cannot have a bad mind, remember. Because brain ka healthy hona zaruri hai ek acche mind le, remember. If brain is not healthy, then you cannot expect a sound mind, okay? So memory is one of the faculty of a mind by which any information that is of previous exposure or present undergoes four phenomena: encoding, storing and retaining, and retrieval. Somewhere I've seen storing and retaining, they say one, few textbooks. Somewhere it is separate. Encoding, so human body is made up of five senses. Nose, eye, ear, and touch whole body, and taste. So whatever we are coming across, it's in a physics form, okay? Like it's in a touch receptors, then it would meet higher karva hoga. So everything has to encode in the form of a nerve conduction language, okay? The neuron will take away that information. Then storing, before that hippocampus does this job of indexing and consolidation of the memory. Then store karta hai, then retaining bhi karta hai. Means whole life retain karna bhi ek kaam hai brain ka. Means is we don't know kab after 20 years, 30 years aapko achanak yaad aata hai ki wo koi dost tha. And then successful retrieval is also necessary. And memory is vital to the experiences, and the retention of information over the time is useful for the purpose of influencing future actions. I mean to say, future actions aapke tabhi acche hoenge jab aapke paas pehla information ka batch ya acha memory hai, acha ek mind hai, wo proper hai. And if we can't remember past events, then we can't learn or develop new language, relationship or personal identity and much more. Aapne dekha hoga, in old days many people have amnesia. They keep forgetting. That time their mind is not sound. Sometimes they behave something. Memory is being understood as an informational processing system with explicit and implicit functioning. Explicit and implicit, I mean to say, explicit functioning means, you say, words mein explain kiya ja sakta hai, that I can explain in word and I can teach a student on a notebook. And implicit is that cannot be explained with the words. Like, I know cycling, but if you ask me, how I do cycling, I will just say कि मैं cycle चलाना आता है, but एक unknown person जिसे cycle नहीं चलाना आता, मैं words में उसे explain नहीं कर सकता. Like he has to condition himself to learn a cycle. This is implicit. That is made up of sensory processor, short-term and long-term memory. And thus, memories are the representations of the past experiences. And that is necessary for each day, each moment to all of us. So there is an encoding of information, as I told you. It is necessary because there are lot of kind of senses coming up in a physical form in the body. It should be encoded. Then storage and retention is necessary in the brain. And then recalling or recollection of the information is very much necessary in a true way. Retrieval is calling back the stored information in response to some cue. So whenever you need some memory, you need a cue. Like until unless I ask you ki aapne 10th kahan kiya tha, tabhi to aap hit karenge ki maine 10th wahan se kiya tha ya 8th maine wahan se kiya tha. So there's always a cue that gives memory to recall back. So now coming back, so I was asked by the director of All India Radio when I was in meeting that he was asking, you are a neurobiologist, can you tell me the difference, what is the memory difference? This many people keep asking. So I told like there's a basic differences and I will give one presentation on All India Radio. So this was before that. So the memory is a constructive process, as you know, through which we can organize and shape information and incidences. All right. Computer memory can be erased and overwritten. But for mind, it is not necessary. If you say you delete this information, you forget this information, sometime ulta ho jayega, because you will do regurgitation or recalling back, and recalling as more happens, so memory gets more consolidated. Ulta ho jayega. If I say corona mat, yeah, to aap kahenge ki, right? So this is very much contrast. Human memory is based on interconnection synapse. So as I was telling you, there are 86 billion neurons in the brain, and each neuron make a like a jungle kind of thing, in that all trees are interwoven to each other and they make synapses. Synapses are for nerve conduction. It's a space where the neurotransmitters pass on from one dendrite to another one. And brain is a parallel machine while computer is a serially fitted machine. This is important. This I will explain in this video of few minutes. So memories are not stored and retrieved the way the files on a computer chip. So this is my YouTube video about, because it is related to the human brain and related to this one. So I will play this video just few minutes, 6-7 minutes, or I will skip it.
पिछले कुछ वर्षों में artificial intelligence AI या कृत्रिम बुद्धिमत्ता उन प्रमुख शब्दों में से एक है जिसे दुनिया भर में वेबसाइट्स पर अधिक से अधिक सर्च किया गया है. असल में आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस किसी कंप्यूटर के द्वारा दिखाई जाने वाली अपनी बुद्धिमत्ता को कहा जाता है, जो कि कंप्यूटर की मशीन इंटेलिजेंस का एक महत्वपूर्ण अंग होती है. वो एक व्यापक समानांतर में बहुत कुछ काम कर सकते
हैं. कंपैरिजन, सो our memories lie somewhere in the 100 trillion synapses. So those 86 billion neurons make up to 100 trillion synapses, because each neuron is made up of more than 1,000 dendrites. Okay, so as many more synapses, more probability of getting the memory. Now this model you might have heard of, Atkinson-Sifrin model of human memory. It is made up of three parts: sensory memory, short-term memory and long-term memory. So each and every second you are having a lot of sensory input you are coming across. If you pay an attention, that time it becomes short-term memory. If you pay an attention, if you don't pay attention, then it will be washed off. If you pay attention and then properly encode it, then it will be part of long-term memory. And then from long-term memory, it can come to the short-term memory later on when you need it. So there are three memory: iconic memory, which is visual sensory memory that you see, echoic memory that you listen or auditory information, and haptic memory that is touch memory. That happens in the braille language you might have across. They take help of this haptic memory to read out. And in a court litigation you might have heard, jab judge poochta hai, to they ask echoic memory and iconic memory, wo kaisa tha, kya bol raha tha, inhi cheezon ko hum pack karte hain. And Miller's magic number 7 plus minus 2, it says that each
every time, you know, this short-term memory remains 7 plus minus 2, like 5 to 9 bits of information. Because you are not paying attention, then it will be washed off after some time. So it remain only, that's why if you are being asked to remember someone's mobile number, then you chunk it like 989, then 239. So you chunk it like 10 digits in a 2-3 chunks so that you can remember it further and you can note it down. Okay, so memory is short-term, sensory memory, every moment it is coming to your body, short-term memory and long-term memory. Long-term memory is made up of explicit and implicit. Implicit is the procedural memory, as I told you, like cycling, etc. And then another classification say they are declarative memory, that can be explained in the birds, is semantic memory, that is general knowledge, like Taj Mahal lies in Agra or Qutub Minar is in Delhi, and episodic memory, then like you remember of your past education or life. So long-term memory is like this, allows storage of information for a long period of time, perhaps permanently, and its capacity is essentially unlimited. And this much unlimited is 2.4 petabytes, I will explain in another slide. So our brain does not store memories in one unified structure as might be seen in a computer hard disk. Rather, different types of memories are stored in different regions of the brain. It means like if you are fond of jalebi, then the memory of that sweet, like iska structure ek part mein kahin hoga, iska taste jalebi kis shop ki achhi hai, wo ek memory kisi aur part mein hogi. So each memory or color, taste, etc., they are lying in a different part of the brain. And that's why sometimes happens that you forget ki wo achha to tha sweet, lekin ye pata nahi ki wo kis dukaan par tha. So it means the brain is so smart, wo ek jagah pe store nahi karta ek memory ko, usse parts mein divide karke alag jagah rakhta, so that at least you have a hint in next time when you at least have a amnesia to some extent. Okay, explicit is a declarative memory, just now I told you autobiographical. This is implicit memory, that is procedural memory, like walking is also implicit memory, jo bachpan mein hum seekh liye hote hain, theek hai? And cycle chalana, car driving, and this needs unconscious memory, like you can have a phone call during your car driving also, so sometime it remain on a auto mode. And sleep and long-term memory, they are closely related, so sleep is necessary. Some theories consider sleep to be an important factor in establishing well-organized long-term memory. Indeed, the sleep plays a key function in the indexing and consolidation. These two words are important, indexing and consolidation of the new memories. And research suggests that sleep helps learning and memory in two distinct ways. First, as we know that sleep-deprived person can't focus attention optimally. And secondly, sleep itself has a role in the indexing and consolidation of memory. So when we do night sleep, that time we come across REM and non-REM sleep, rapid eye movement and non-rapid eye movement. That it's a cyclic nature, about 4 cycles of REM and 4 non-REM comes. During REM cycle, we have a dream. But we remember the dream of the last REM sleep, jo say 4 or 5 o'clock, 5 o'clock, agar aap last REM sleep kiya hai. वही हमें याद रहता है. And dreams are very much necessary for the memory also. So this was my another video about the dreams. In that I was explaining the biology of the dreams, how dreams come across in the REM sleep, types of dreams, and interpretation in the various religions like Hindu mythology and other mythology, they have different meanings and interpretations of dreams. And how dream is necessary for a memory. So dream is not a bad thing that you come across. And these are, you know, dreams that we come across for future. They tell about the future. You remember capillary structure that came up in a dream, capillary structure, the Benjamin structure. Now coming to that amnesia, how this happens, loss of long-term memory. So amnesics are the people with severe memory deficit following brain surgery or like TBI, as I told you, or injury, or it could be neurodegeneration also. Neurodegeneration happens on its own by molecular or anatomical function like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's or any such disease. Otherwise, TBI, traumatic brain injury, is the main. Amnesia, forgetfulness, is two parts.
anterograde amnesia. In that, after a particular incident or accident or brain tumor or trauma or brain surgery, newer memory formation stops. But pichla memory as such bana rehta hai. This is called anterograde amnesia. Similarly, retrograde amnesia, in that after the surgery, person forgets everything of the past, but newer memory formation remain very much correct in the person. And then there's a word, transient global amnesia in neurobiology. That happens to we all of us, okay? One day or another day, you might come across this TGA, transient global amnesia, that you go to your room and then you forget for what purpose you have come, and then you are thinking, oh, for what purpose I have come here? And then all after 5 minutes or 10 minutes, you come across, oh, I was searching this thing. So it's a sudden, temporary episode of memory loss that can't be attributed to a common neurological. It's a common phenomenon. And amnesia is very much necessary for a healthy brain. As otherwise, if amnesia is not there, then it will be havoc in a situation. Like, agar kisi ko tragedy hoti hai, agar wo ro raha hai, agar amnesia type ki cheez nahi hogi, to rota hi rahega kai din tak, ya hasta hi rahega. So nature has made such kind of system that many things have one language should be studied. Beech mein hame topic change karna chahiye. Like 2 hours neurobiology, to kuch physics padhna hai ya maths padhna hai. Spacing is necessary. Without spacing, memory formation is like there is a plateau phase otherwise. Be emotionally involved. As you know, schedule and read in chunks. Use visual aids and mnemonics that I'm using here with the help of some videos. However, I'm not. So how the information of human memory is known to us today? So this guy, Henry Gustav Mollison, he passed away around 11 years back. He was the first person from which lot of study of memory that we were talking about just now, short-term, long-term, and sensory memory has come across. Memory disorder patient who had a bilateral medial temporal lobectomy. So in 1954, he was having epilepsy. Epilepsy in that scissors comes and person gets fall down. And then doctor did lobotomy of the temporal lobe. Lobotomy means part of the brain removal. So doctor decided to take off this hippocampus, major part of the hippocampus and amygdala from the limbic system he removed. Surgery was successful. He was in a coma for like 4 or 6 days. Then he came up and then he was released to home. All of a sudden, then the family members observed that he's having anterograde amnesia. Means new memory formation was not there. So like doctor is coming every day and he keep asking, who is this guy? And his first wife son used to come and they say, who is this? I don't know. And aaj naam bataye fir kal poochta tha. So this way he was having this. And then after that he was interviewed by more than 150 psychologists and neuropsychologists, and they gave lot of, you know, some questions or questionnaire or some testing. And that time they come across, because lobotomy was done to remove hippocampus, so this problem has because of this. Okay, and he was HM had a severe problem, the new semantic knowledge.
This HM, is me doing that. This is a very famous explaining way to probe HM to remember HM, what he did yesterday and tell you about it.
We don't say the patient name until he's died or the family gives. So he was given HM, not Henry Mollison. Now he's no more in the world, so we can say. The other one for the memory part is Clive Wearing. He was a musician related to BBC. And Dinah Spencer ki jab shaadi thi 1983, that time he was in charge of that musical concert. So he was quite okay up to that time. He was in the very good professional career as a musician, tenor and keyboardist and musicologist. In 1984, all of a sudden, he had an herpes viral encephalitis. Encephalitis means, itis means swelling, so it was a brain swelling because of this virus attack. And then, all of a sudden, it happened so that he had a both anterograde amnesia and retrograde amnesia. So he forgot the past event and he was not able to make newer memory. Every morning, whenever he was awake, just after awake, he used to take a pen and notebook and he used to write only few words because uske paas sirf 30 seconds ka hi memory rehta tha. So he just write, I'm alive, or I'm very much alive, I'm very fortunate to be alive. Phir se wohi sentence aa jayega, I'm alive. Isse aage nahi likh paata tha ye. Okay, and then he says, I'm totally awake now, I'm just awake. And then every morning he used to ask, acha, ye iski jo wife thi, wife, he only remember his wife because he was emotionally attached. She was the exceptional, he just remembered the name and he used to talk and behave with her only. And usse har roz ye kehta tha ki, I was in the coma since long, why you're not taken to a doctor? Mujhe doctor ke paas le chalo. Wo aise sochta tha, wo coma mein se bhi jagah hai. And he is still alive, clavering. He is 81 year old right now in London. He is still alive. In that, you know, he plays this piano, but only 30 seconds that he uska chalta.
One man is consigned to live entirely within the present. 20 years ago,
he just
little
he,
as perhaps dobrized
the wife.
Seconds.
Yes, it's like emotionally attached. Now she's telling him, aapki daughter aayi thi, to phir 2 minute baad puchta ki, kyun is kaam film mein gayi? Phir puchega, phir puchega. Sirf ek hi because 30 seconds se zyada memory hi nahi hoti isme. So he's one of the live experiment kind of human, jisse sirf wo yaad rehta hai. Last year I gave this presentation here about human brain and memory and neurobics. Neurobics, I have not told you just now, just like aerobics is for the like a muscle mass, neurobics are for the brain. So there are some brain exercises in that we can have a healthy brain. If healthy brain, so healthy mind, okay? This is the same dice here where I was. So these neurobic exercises, even though neuroprotective phytomedicines are there, like almond, akhrot khana, there are several things, you know, those are proven phytomedicine, neuroprotective phytomedicines are there. But there are some exercises that I will explain here. So this brain I will skip, I already told, this is the structural and function unit as a neuron. All neurons make a dendritic cover like this evergreen forest. So there are a lot of neurons keep interacting from each other in whole 1.4 kg brain. This is the recent technology brain bow. It is multicolor immunofluorescence assay. And when I was in Cornell University, my lab was using this technique. However, this picture is taken from internet. In that, we can give the multiple colors, up to 20 colors in various neurons. And we can see that typical brain interactome at the same time. And then we can take an image also. This is study is being done on a mice, but similar study can also be done on a human, but there are ethical considerations, it's not that easy. I told you brain is a hardware and mind is like a software. This already is proven, just like it's an analog, it's not the exactly same. This already I told you, three model memory. So learning and memory is an integral part of our practical life. Our ultimate behavior, communication, education and worldly knowledge, etc. are the culmination of stored millions and millions of bits of information stored in the memory bag of our brain and mind. That's why we keep doing education one after one degree and we become more cognitive. It's similar like directly proportional probably. More educated, so more cognitive probably. And this is, so like a brain is very much plastic. You use it, so you can enhance the functioning of the brain. If you don't use it, then it will be also an idle situation and then you will be less cognitive. So never ever be shy to use the brain. Now coming to that, how much brain capacity could have? So don't be scared that we should, if we are reading this much, then our brain bhar jayega ya hame pura bhar jayega, jagah nahi hai. So Paul Reaver, this scientist from Northwestern University, in a conference he was asked, you are a neuropsychologist, why not you tell ये किसी ने मजाक में कहा था कि यू टेल द ब्रेन कैपेसिटी कितनी होती है. सो यू टुक अ चैलेंज, यू टोल नेक्स्ट टाइम कॉन्फ्रेंस में जब मिलेंगे दैट टाइम आई विल गिव माय कैलकुलेशन, आई विल डू सम सिमुलेशन. सो ही केम अक्रॉस टू टेल दैट ब्रेन कैपेसिटी ऑफ अ हेल्दी ह्यूमन ब्रेन इज 2.5 पेटाबाइट्स. दिस पेटा इज इक्वल टू यू नो हाउ मच, 2.5 lakh GB. दीज आर ओनली 8 GB ओके ऑन माई forehead. This so this is equalizing 4.6 billion books. Itna sara books aa jayega. And if you have a if somehow you do brain to computer intersection possible, then our brain can run a HD movie for 300 years continuously. So this much capacity now, amazing. 300 saal tak full HD mein chalta rahega, itna capacity hai. So don't be shy to use it, okay. So these are aerobics, these are neurobics for the brain, and I will tell you these are 5 senses already we all are having from the God side. 5 senses we all have. Now I will come across, you know, how to increase that neurobics exercise. So you have to involve more than one senses together, okay. I mean, until unless you're not involving more than one sense, that's why आपने देखा हो क्लास में अगर जो बच्चा लिखता है टीचर के नोट्स के साथ, probably that is better way. If I'm in your shoes, I would have done that way, okay? मैं लिख रहा होता rather than just listening the commentary, because here only ear sense is working. Remember, when you write that time eye, ear, there's at least 2-3 coordination happening. So that gives better retention. Engage your full attention. Without attention, आपको पता है half attention में नहीं होगा. And then do non-routine base of doing things. Non-routine base, if you are right-handed person, then you use for some extent in a daytime the left hand. Like I should try to scribble down with my left hand. He is my son, and I ask that can he take his favorite shampoo bottle, you know, by the just shape of bottle, shape, size, the texture, the thickness, etc. And even the weight, because weight he knows by the previous day memory. So this way you should do the non-routine way. Similarly, if you are going from place A to place B, don't take the same route every day. You should try to use other way around, like some, jaise yahan se jana hai to, you can take the Kamla Nagar or somewhere. That time your brain is in an active phase, you are learning new things, in you are having brain active. Otherwise, same route pe chalte hain, to hume, you know, sometime unconsciously bhi chalte hain. So you should keep brain in an active mode. So non-dominant hand use karna hoga, ya be ambidextrous. Be ambidextrous means ek haath se nahi to dono haathon se at least we should try to do something, because you remember when for a right-handed man it is left brain hemisphere more active, it is like it's on more load than the left. However, both networks are necessary. And try to upside down the calendar or watch ko ulta pehne, ya fir aap apne aap figure out karein ki abhi time kitna ho raha hai. So that time you are in active phase. These are some brain exercises. So you don't need to go to a gym, rather you can do bidhi only. And sometime you make a TV mute and then try to figure out the meanings of by the gesture, by the frowning, by the love, anger and the emotions. Can you make out some meaning? Or even sometime try to have a scribble down the cartoons. कार्टून में क्या आप वो भावना ला सकते हैं, जैसे कोई हंस रहा है तो हंसने का बना दें. दीज ऑल आर ब्रेन एक्सरसाइज. आई मीन टू से लाइक इफ हाफ एन आर यू गिविंग सच न्यूरोबिक्स, ओके. बी ए पॉलीग्लॉट. पॉलीग्लॉट मीन्स मल्टीपल लैंग्वेजेस. इफ आर लकी टू हैव अ मोर देन वन लैंग्वेज, हिंदी, इंग्लिश, तमिल, तेलुगु, पंजाबी, दैट टाइम सर्टेनली यू आर बेटर देन हु आर नॉट नोइंग मोर लैंग्वेजेस. एंड नो बेटर यू आर नॉट अ गुड शेफ, but try to go to kitchen and try to have a curry preparation, in that you use your texture for the consistency of the food, you use your smell power ki abhi khana bana ki nahi bana, you use your eye sense and whistling ki city kaan se, to there lot of engagement are happening. So this way also is a good way. Be a numismatic. So my son is counting all the coins of several countries, so I gave a challenge, then Can you tell me which is dinar or real or kroner, Danish kroner or dollar? So first I gave a challenge that can he find out the shape, size, and even the texture of the word, and then try to segregate properly. That this is that
coin or this is that coin. Even weight ko feel karke we can make a sense. Okay? And try to have all, you know, multiple habits all the way. Like if I'm a neurobiologist, you might have seen I'm quite active in other parts like going to radio and TV, etc. So this way I'm having my hobby and my brain is more active. I take challenges. And that's why you go to the swimming or sports playing, like keep doing few hours for extracurricular activity. These are also necessary for a healthy brain. Don't do routine based, otherwise you will be in a comfort zone. Rather you have a better ideas, new ideas, and have a, you know, expanding zone of your professional or academics career. So this t-shirt gives a lot of messages for the brain. Use it or lose it. If you don't use it, then certainly you are losing a lot of brain. So brain exercises for good memories, test your recall, enjoy music. Music is also good therapy. Mathematics challenges in the mind. Enjoy cooking habit, just now I told you. Learn a foreign language, be a polyglot, bi or trilingualism. Word picture ko understand karna, draw map from memory. Challenge your taste words, refine the hand-eye coordination. Jaise sui mein dhaga dalne ka, that gives, you know, better eye coordination for the occipital lobe. And learn a new habit, okay? And the brain has a very good, this is my last topic now, so if you're bored, just wait for another few more minutes. Neuroplasticity, it's for adaptive brain. So like this is the rewiring of the brain network, okay? So the brain continually reorganizes itself by forming new neural connections throughout the life. And this phenomenon is called neuroplasticity. The other names are brain plasticity, neuroelasticity, or neural plasticity. It's the ability of the brain to change continuously throughout an individual's life. For example, brain activity associated with a given function can be transferred to a different location. The proportion of gray matter can change and synapse may strengthen and weaken. So keep doing, you know, newer things. It is made up of two parts, like structural plasticity. In that brain structure changes. This happens in a long-term meditation patient, long-term meditation subjects. Like if you are having 20, 30 years or more than period of meditators, they have a corpus callosum thickening. Even premotor cortex changes, you know, to a little bit. This is being studied by fMRI, you know, structural. Then other one is functional plasticity. In that functional part or the brain functioning. This is studied by EEG, electroencephalograph or electromagnetoencephalograph, EMG, etc. In that functional part, that is like a nerve conduction between one brain part or one nuclei of the brain part to another happens. So the purpose of neuroplasticity is to optimize the neural network during phylogenesis, ontogeny, physiological learning, and especially after brain injury. Aapne ye bahut zyada dekha hoga in common parlance. आप ब्रेन इंजरी पेशेंट को देखना जो कई महीने तक कोमा में रहा या एक दो साल बाद ठीक हो गया, यू नो दे डेवलप न्यूर हैबिट्स. वो कुछ एक्स्ट्रा ऑर्डिनरी हो जाते हैं किसी के काम के लिए. जैसे दिस इज द ब्रेन, इन दैट दिस राइट पार्ट ऑफ ऑक्सीपिटल लोब, नियर बाय दैट पार्ट और ऑक्सीपिटल लोब इज डैमेज्ड, देन दिस न्यूरल नेटवर्क ऑफ फंक्शनिंग ऑफ दिस पार्ट मे ट्रांसफर टू दैट नियर बाय पार्ट. And this way a person becomes equally good, or at least he can compensate the loss of function. So child brain is very much neuroplastic. A child can learn many things rather than an adult, okay? And this is a brain's rewiring, slowly using other pathway to bypass, yeah. So their brain connections, you know, get changed. This example you might have come across on TV. She's Jeeva, daughter of former captain Dhoni, right? She knows 6 languages now onwards. She is, I think, 5-year-old. And this is one of the greatest examples of neuroplasticity. She understands very fantastic. She's not, writing is not there, but understanding and speaking is there. Tamil, Bangla, Gujarati, Bhojpuri, Punjabi, and Urdu. She is perfect polyglot. When I was in Denmark for a year or so, then that time I was learning Danish, so I used to learn, but now I forgot. Now I came back to Hindi and English. So this way, and shorter working hours leads to the rise in productivity. this is another part, like if I give a challenge, a boss give danda to you and then 8 ghante ka kaam 1 ghante mein ho jata hai. This is also, you know, this happens in today's world. And this word impossible is, I impossible, this is very much true. Means this is related to the brain biology in my sense that everything is possible, you just show the passion for that. Passion and dedication and behavior. And that was the reason around 2 months back, when 22nd July, when ISRO was about to launch Chandrayaan 2. So 2 days back, the producer of asked, he is my friend, so he asked me, can you be there in my panel to explain? So I told, I'm a biologist, so I will explain the life on the moon. So he told, okay, but you study the physics of PSLB-2 and this all, because we don't know, the anchor may ask any question because you will be in a live discussion. So this will be embarrassing, and live discussion is very much attentive job. So I told, okay, I will do this also. So I was keep reading ISRO and NASA, and I was talking about my all friends from abroad, and I was able to understand all payloads, then you know, how much weight, how the, you know, this satellite works, this all functioning, and I spent quite comfortably 3 hours. And then when Chandrayaan was about to reach moon on 6th and 7th after 46 days, then India TV gave me the opportunity that I should be for 4.5 hours now, live for whole night to give live commentary. And even though I'm a biologist, but I was able to explain the physics also. I was telling about the extraterrestrial intelligence, extraterrestrial life, and the future endeavors, how human will go to Mars and Venus or other planets, keeping stoppage at moon, and how the moon will be used as a laboratory, as a refreshment for the astronauts and cosmonauts. And then Lok Sabha TV also called me upon to the parliament, and then again I was able to explain this all. So this is my habit, like I took a challenge, I learn everything. So this way you also learn anything, don't be ashamed, keep learning, you know, very thing. Don't just constrict also just to your science, okay. You might have listened me, I'm also one MBA at all, but I'm second MBA is also ongoing, you know, HR management, other than my biology. So I can do anything. I have to use my brain. So this way you also use it. Okay? So use it or lose it. This is my last message to you. Probably I could make a sense to you to motivate you. Thank you so much.